So morning, I am Seshadri. Of course, I am associated with a lot of organizations. I would like to highlight only three things. One is, of course, already people, some of my colleagues has talked about something about my university technology business incubator. I just make an open invitation for any colleges, institutions working on technology-based promotion. And you can send all your students for technology-based promotion. That is one thing I can give you, open invitation. And second thing is Bharatiya Yuva Shakti Trust Functioning Insights Confederation of Indian Industry. Of course, Xavier was highlighting about this. In fact, I must thank Xavier for providing facilities for even organizing the North Chapter meetings of BYST there. That is another platform really through which we help a lot of entrepreneurs from the bottom of the pyramid. It is not that any area entrepreneurs can come and approach us, we will be happy to help us. It's a pan-India organization, functioning from Chennai, of course, Hyderabad, Ahmedabad, Guwahati, all these areas, and of course 11 centers are there. We are still expanding. Of course, it has a lot of relationship with YBI and directly under the control of Prince Charles, UK. That way it has a lot of connections with UK that way, and we are helping a lot of entrepreneurs. It is not that related to food or engineering or anything. Anybody can come and approach this. That way I can invite all people to send students. The third platform I would say is a small non-profit organization, of course, through which we engage a lot of our non-profit organizations in Tamil Nadu and other areas. It's Indigenous and Frontier Technology Research Center. There it's a different kind of incubation, innovation happening, mostly through the bottom, more than the bottom of it, I would say, from the rural areas. And one thing I just want this discussion also to highlight is more than integrating and even institutionalizing programs like CSR, all these things, how to reach out the entrepreneurs from the rural environment informally. That is the most important thing we really need to discuss. That's one thing I just wanted to. Thank you so much for the opportunity.
Hi everyone. So, this session, so about to 1 o'clock, I'll be talking about UKISEEN. I'll be talking about how we originally designed it, our intentions, our strategic aims, our objectives. But then I want to open it over to you and open the floor up to find out if these objectives and if these aims actually meet what the membership wants. If it doesn't, then we need to think again about how best to use the tools we have to actually meet your needs. As I said, you know, the network is a constantly evolving beast, and we want to respond to the challenges you face and ensure that we do solve the problems which you currently experience. But let me start by talking about some of our strategic aims. So we had, when we started this, when we first conceived it, way back in September 2015, we had about 5 strategic aims. And then after the conference, we refined these again. When we spoke to members who came to our conference in April, and we found out what some of those challenges were, and then we sought again to refine what exactly is that UKISEEN does. But these are some of our strategic aims, and you know, they're pretty broad. So, firstly, to facilitate the exchange of ideas between UK and Indian social entrepreneurs, and those social entrepreneurs based at universities, we're not obviously working across the entire ecosystem, our focus is on higher education institutions. The second, and this for us was very important, you know, based on both of our universities and our expertise in engineering and science and tech, was to promote the exchange of innovative uses of data and tech for social innovation. For us, it's very important. With some of the best social innovation that we're seeing both in India and the UK is tech-driven. And having heard from most of you, that tech is a very big part of what it is you do and how you engage some of your students as well. Thirdly, and a bit more broadly, is trying to facilitate the exchange of talent between the UK and Indian ecosystems. You've heard that there are some people here who aren't from universities, some people from incubators, some people from incubators for early starts, early stage social enterprise as well. That for us is really important. Speaking from our experience in the UK, we are always part of an ecosystem, whether a university in a big city or a small city. You'll feel the benefits or you'll feel the drawbacks of not being connected to those kinds of organizations. So what we wanted to do is to ensure that those universities who are starting on their journeys have the means to connect to those kinds of non-university organizations who are already working with social enterprises or who they can provide a pipeline for. So you know, maybe you yourselves don't have the resources to incubate social enterprises. You don't have to think about doing that within your own university. You could then locate and identify other incubators who may be more able and tailored to a specific type of social entrepreneurship, who then you could feed into. We really wanted to build a vibrant community of student and social entrepreneurs in the UK and India, and it's great to see some students here. For us, this has always been a two-tiered network. Firstly, it's faculty, but secondly, it's about connecting students. Sometimes it works in a very natural way that faculty and faculty will talk and then they'll filter down to students. But we also think there's huge scope for peer-to-peer network between UK and Indian social entrepreneurs. That's not to say that the challenges we face are exactly the same, but in many ways we speak a common language. In many ways there are shared uses of tech, shared business models, where we could take different elements and we can use them to improve their own practice in different ways. So we're not talking about, you know, the kind of wholesale replication of social enterprise models between the UK and India, but there's certainly room and scope for cross-fertilization of ideas, and that's what I think we really want to aspire to. We talked about incubators and universities, but equally there are other organizations that we think are very important to the ecosystem. Corporate business, you know, we've had a few people here speak about the role of corporate business. Both in the UK and India, that's increasingly important, and corporate businesses are seeing that they themselves have a really important role. At our university, one of the best things we were able to do was to tap into some of the corporate businesses around us and give their expertise. And often, you know, if you have a social venture or a particular social or environmental challenge that hits home with a corporate business, they will voluntarily give their time to help support that on a pro bono basis. So finding ways to engage corporate business in some of these big social and environmental challenges is very important. And we hope that through the strength of our network, we can help to engage those corporate businesses where perhaps as individual universities, we perhaps might struggle. Working with NGOs, I think, is also vitally important. Sometimes when we talk about social enterprise, we go to a very for-profit route, and we sometimes forget that there have been NGOs dealing with these challenges and problems for decades and even longer. And we need to tap into that level of expertise as well, so that we're not operating in a vacuum. One thing we always hear is, we hear of, you know, having worked in this space for a long time now, is when students say, I want a social enterprise to tackle a particular problem. You know, they may be talking about clean energy or clean water. And they'll talk as though they were the first people to ever think about that problem in the world. And of course they aren't. There are NGOs, there are organizations who've been working on these issues for a very, very long time. And if we don't tap into their expertise, then we're not starting from the problem, we're starting from the solution. And we need to start to orientate ourselves to engage problem solvers from across the wider ecosystem. So those are our broad aims. These are some of the ways in which we started to realize those aims into our objectives and some of the activities which we've been running. So first, and we'll be talking about this a little bit later, is running an online portal to help bring our network members together. And our intentions are trying to help diffuse best practice. I think, you know, we've heard that there are so many different models out there. It's sometimes hard to know who's doing what. And again, in the same way that we don't want to replicate, we don't want people starting from scratch, we want to shorten that learning curve. If we can have the models of excellent practice in promoting social entrepreneurship on our platform, then we'll shorten that learning curve for new members and new institutions who are looking to embed social entrepreneurship at their institution. We want to identify some of the common challenges. I think they move all the time. I think the challenges that we faced when I started working in this field 4 years ago are not the same challenges that we face now. I think the challenges move on all the time. And so we need the membership to be alive to those challenges and how they're shifting, and to bring those to our kind of collective need, and for us then to respond to them in the appropriate ways. We're talking about running competitions and challenges. And we are going to be talking about one of those very soon, which is the inaugural UK-India Social Innovation Challenge, and that's focused on clean water. We want, and this is one of our more ambitious projects, to create a library of student social ventures which is searchable by Sustainable Development Goals. So using an online innovation platform called Babel, we want to be able to showcase the best, and not just the best, but all social ventures dealing with specific social challenges. And I think the language of the Sustainable Development Goals offers us that platform and that opportunity. So Babel is basically the platform that we'll be using for the UK Innovation, Social Innovation Challenge, and we'll talk about that a little bit later. But what's important, I think, is that for this network to try and embrace open source innovation. And this has been a big challenge across the world. In the UK, it's been a big issue. Social entrepreneurs want to keep their IP to themselves. But actually, you know, social innovation requires all of us to be open and to share what we're doing, to share our models, to share the innovations we have, to shorten that learning curve, as I said, because what we want to do is to do things at scale. And we can only do that if we operate in an open source innovation economy. We want to connect student social entrepreneurs in UK and India with expertise in all kinds of fields. So, you know, I talked about corporate business. I said also about those working on specific challenges, those who aren't in a for-profit space. That's vitally important. And again, we think that through Babel, we can do that, and we can get corporate businesses involved through online, to be online mentors. That's what that platform allows. The platform has been used a few times. We used it ourselves within our university. We now want to open it out to everyone who's part of the network, whether they're in the UK or India, so they can make use of all the talent which is available to help mentor social ventures. So that's how it's been conceived. They're the kind of things that we're doing now. What I'd like is to open it up to the floor and to try and get a feel for whether we are actually hitting those pain points and we are actually responding to the challenges which you face on the ground. So what I'd like is to get out of your very plush seats, which look like very, very comfortable theatre seats, and I'd like you to go and talk to someone you don't know and just talk about a challenge which you face as an institution or an individual in promoting social entrepreneurship. Okay, I'm going to give you about 5 minutes for that. So once you speak to one person, quickly move on and speak to someone else. All right? So out of your seats and start talking to someone else.
For us, it's mainly about learning English to these people who are starting to get more.
Okay, if you can wrap up with that person you're speaking with now and move on to someone else. Okay. All right. Now's crunch time to find out if you've been talking about demonetization, Brexit, Trump, or something else. This, I have to admit, this was, I've been on several trips since June 23rd. This is the first time I've been at an event and no one's asked me about Brexit yet. So keep it up. Don't ask me about Brexit if you don't want me to have a severe nervous breakdown. Right. So, here's what I'd like you to do. Yeah. Just as a kind of, I'm really fascinated by this. Demonetization. Raise your hand if you think long term. All right, just forget long term, short term. Who thinks it's a good idea? Is it a good idea? Ooh. That's exactly like a Brexit vote. You're almost 48-52% split. Is to prove whether our network is effective. So hopefully this will work. What I would like is for, I'm just going to ask people to volunteer the challenges that they came up with. So in your groups, hopefully you're talking about the challenges you face as individuals or institutions in embedding and promoting social entrepreneurship. So let me have some volunteers. What challenges do you face? Whatever you were doing was more popular than what I was doing, so... It's okay. Yes?
So our challenge is providing an ecosystem for social entrepreneurship in tier 2 and tier 3 cities and towns.
Okay. It's not writing. It's going
to write a little.
That's better. How many people here are from an institution or an organization which is in a tier 2 or tier 3 city? Okay. Right. Someone else, another challenge you face, yes?
I think the bigger challenge, you know, as an educator and everybody, is to change the mindset of students. Like currently, they are having the mindset that doing something as a social enterprise or social entrepreneur, it really not profitable, it doesn't earn much, and even many of them consider this to be an inferior thing than the regular enterprise. So that mindset has to be changed, and the network has enough potential to do that.
Yeah, that's a good one. I heard that when we were doing the introduction, that motivating students was a fairly common challenge for a lot of people. Yes, a third challenge.
I think I talked about it already, which is showcasing ourselves, you know, and I said this last year as well, because the narrative on social innovation and entrepreneurship is still binary, it's still students and investors. Within the framework of educational institutions, there's some place for educators, but you know, is there a way in which we can, as independents or people working with various organizations, showcase our talent skills like a LinkedIn for people in our space? Because a lot of people in the room I can easily work with, but how do I find them and how can they find me?
Okay. Thank you.
Second one is funding in various ways. I'm sure everybody will nod when I say this.
Okay. can't see my face, but I'm nodding as well. Yeah. One more. Let me take only one more.
Only one point there. Normally, I used to talk to a lot of entrepreneurs. Every week, I am meeting more than 100 entrepreneurs. The one thing always I find is lack of mentoring.
Lack of mentoring?
Mentoring. That is an important requirement for all the entrepreneurs. And every sphere of their approach, they find difficulty in getting mentors to address some kind of problems in some ways.
Yes, that's a common one. Amongst social entrepreneurs,
yes.
specifically, not actually universities, but social entrepreneurs. Okay. Why don't we put sharing experiences here? All right. What I want is does anyone have a really burning need to articulate one more challenge? Very entrepreneurial, just stand up. No, it's okay.
There are a lot of need actually for the society. People are not able to identify, you know, what is the real social need.
Right.
Yeah.
That's good.
And not addressing, not addressing the real need. Aren't identified. Especially clean water, if you are talking about.
Yeah.
We have a lot of water, but no. There are no measures that have taken for not getting the water and feeding to the common people, not public.
Okay, thank you. Right, sorry, I'm going to stop there, but, because we could go on. What I would like now is if, Sandeep, could you give out A3 sheets? Could the people who raised their, who nominated each of these challenges, please raise their hand? And Sandeep, could you give them sheets of A3 paper, please? Thank you. It is. But let's try and fold that into something else if we can.
New area of doing business, so start pushing themselves from this normal business to social entrepreneurship. It's a fashionable word, and that's why they will earn more money rather than doing the normal business.
Please keep your hand raised if you have.
So one of my friend, he is doing business on eco, that's a recycling business. So then I interviewed him. He said, "This is my business, a simple business. For me, this is not a social entrepreneurship. For me, this is business, but I found this is the business where I can earn more money, and this is the area where nobody has touched this area. So this could be one of the area where people think this is a new area for earning money. So there should be need of changing mindset that, of course, this is a business, but this is something for the bottom of the pyramid."
I think it should link to identifying problems and really verifying these that these are actually real problems rather than people trying to create businesses to meet needs which don't actually exist. But I think that's a really good point. Okay, good. What I would like now is for the remainder of the session, or at least maybe for the next 15 minutes, is if you could, so if you're interested in helping to find, to meet the challenge of building ecosystems for tier 2 and 2 and tier 3 cities, go to the person who raised that point. And who is that? That's you. So if you would keep your hand raised, and everyone would congregate over there, if that's something you're interested in solving. If you're interested in motivating students, raise your hand. Who raised the point about motivating students? Yes, you did. So then if you could all go over there to this guy motivating students, and why don't we do this right now, otherwise it'll get confusing. Go to this guy now. What's your name, sorry? Okay, go over there if you want to help support building ecosystems for tier 2 and tier 3 cities. Okay. Motivating students. You want to stand up? Do you want to move out of your seat? It might be easy for people to get to you if you can move out of your seat. So go and join this guy now if that's a problem for you. If motivating students is a problem for you, go and join him now. Good, all right, slowly working. Showcasing our work. That's Aruna there. Join Aruna if that's an issue for you. Number four was funding. Who said funding? Also you. So if you want to do funding as well, you can go to Aruna and talk about funding. Lack of mentors. Who said lack of mentors? Yes, lack of mentors. So if everyone want to go over there, if lack of mentorship is a challenge for you, good. Sharing experiences. This was an issue here. If sharing experiences is a challenge that you face, go over and talk to this lady. And lastly, if identifying problems is something that you face, raise your hand. Who talked about identifying problems? Over here. So if identifying problems is a challenge that you face, go over and speak to this gentleman over there. All right. Good. Now I know this layout isn't very conducive for group discussion, but let's try anyway. So try and make sure you're in a different, that you've all got an A3 sheet there. What we would like is to collect some ideas. So when you discuss the challenge you're facing, after you've discussed the challenge, we'd like you to come up with some ideas about how we can meet that challenge. Okay? So I'm going to give you around 10 to 15 minutes now to discuss the challenge in your groups and then come up with a few solutions.
The most interesting idea was obviously from this group I got collaborating with a group of local academic institutions to form a network. And as a network, we believe that we have a better ability to attract mentors and even entrepreneurs to the area. That was one of the ideas, to have a network of local institutions and use that as the center of attraction. Another one is, wherever there is a missing component of an ecosystem, try to bring some sort of virtualization in place to bridge that gap.
So an online portal.
Yeah, video conferences, if you need a mentor or a functional expert in any field, can you Skype in that person whenever needed?
Yeah.
But I think the challenge still would be doing that on a consistent basis.
Yeah. And maintaining that network over time.
Yeah.
The challenge. Good, thank you very much. A big one, for me at least, well actually maybe not so big, but I know it's a problem. Motivating students. What do you come up with as ideas? Some big ideas for that challenge?
One thing which as a group, you know, we agreed upon that there should be some of the talks about social awareness. So the talk can be started with some people talking about, you know, what are the social problems are there and how that can be solved. And then at next level, bring entrepreneur and social entrepreneur to share their experience. So one group could be from outside, but then also that institute can bring their own students who have gone out and done something in the social entrepreneurship field to come back to their education, to their institute, and talk about how they have done it. So I mean, if the institute can promote in terms of putting their banners and all, saying that this person is the star of our star alumni and all, so this gives a kind of motivation to the student. The second thing which we often is having a 3 months or 6 months kind of field work in the curriculum itself, where the organization can identify a set of NGOs or a set of social organizations and then link up a student group to that organization. So this thing already at IIM Coimbatore we are doing for the MBA program. So they are paired up with one NGO in the second year. So the work, a 6 month for the NGOs, and help them solve real problems.
Okay, that's good. Thank you very much. I mean, I think the second idea is also, it's much easier for those institutions which are established and where they have alumni who are social entrepreneurs, much harder for those who don't. So maybe one way to think about how the local college ecosystem could help to provide some of those alumni social entrepreneurs to go to other colleges and help to share their experiences. I think that's a very good
idea. One way, you know, now is done at our institute is that group of MBA students, we are trying to put some local college students.
Yeah.
So maybe, because one advantage they are having is they have the local language knowledge, which many of the students from our institute doesn't have. So we are pairing up with them so that, you know, it's a kind of knowledge sharing or they are working together. So that kind of a model we can probably
good, thank you. Showcasing our work. There was funding.
Everyone wants to
go. Oh, for God's sake.
There are four different areas. One of the contentions or challenges that we discussed was that a lot of very big chunks of funding are concentrated on the TBI. So then we started questioning technology business incubators.
Okay. Yeah.
And these are significant chunks of funding invested in places that could be spread around more, you know, the largest. So we asked, how can we ask government to become more open and more diverse in its thinking now that we have discussions around Startup India? And then a couple of them said, you know, we have to pitch according to what the government wants to hear. Maybe decentralize it and make it more at a local government level, have metrics that would appeal to them. And we even said we probably need a class of people that are skilled in interacting with government. And maybe a platform like this would help identify and showcase them, because it's a different skill, you know, to build those networks. And there were a few students in the group who said it's very difficult to find money to play with when they have an idea. You know, then we thought, why not have an open source platform where we pool ideas and also investment risk? So instead of one person, you know, several people working in isolation on one idea, why not pool those ideas? And for investors, they also pool investments. Instead of one person investing in it, maybe five different people do it. And this happens in the investment world, right? It's just doing it at a more micro level. And some people said they're a little befuddled by how to tap into corporate funds. Because corporate CSR funding is a behemoth. It has several parts to it. And one of the things that I've heard recently is corporate service engagements where instead of approaching somebody for a pot of money, we say, you know, why don't you have your middle managers or people like those come and participate in learning programs where you charge a premium fee to those, and maybe you pair them up with a student where you charge a subsidized fee and put them through the same learning experiences. The people who participate from the corporate sector get the benefit of mentoring and managing, and the students benefit from the mentoring. So the way to appeal to the corporate sector is also to showcase what is in it for them. And then, you know, opening up discussion. And Mr. Xavier said, why just focus on social enterprises and cast the narrative around social enterprises? There are several organizational structures on the continuum that you can talk about.
Right.
So it's, I think the underlying thread is basically how to not just appear like someone appealing for funding, but how do you showcase yourself or your entity or your venture as someone who can be of value to them?
Yeah, thank you. I mean, I think a really an interim lack of mentors. Yes, you had a very animated discussion in the back.
Thank you very much for including this also in the discussion point. I just would like to say the success of this thing, I could see all the participants were only students.
Yeah.
Though we had a lot of faculties from different organizations, I had only students from all universities. That itself says that everybody needs mentoring. And every institution should identify mentors or different disciplines. They have a college, and every college department should identify a passionate person who can be a mentor for the students from the department or from different departments for mentoring or cross-mentoring. And it's not only technical mentoring, there are a lot of avenues, verticals requiring mentoring also. right from starting, it could be a management problem and or administrative problem, who can help the students. I'm only for institutions talking, I'm not talking about rural area now. For the institutions, right from where the students can go and approach, where to start this initial steps and how to get the things cleared, that's another biggest problem. You can go and get your company registered. Next, what are next steps to be followed? And that itself requires a lot of mentoring. I mean, forming the organization. And next that, like that, the other titles we talked about, the funding. The ideas are the knowledge of the students. But getting funding, getting support from different corners requires mentoring. Next one is the technical mentoring. And after that, of course, a lot of other mentoring is also required in every sphere. And the organizations involved. Involved means involved in entrepreneurship should have identified the mentors for helping the entrepreneurs in different larger domains like marketing, like administration or startups, all these things. And down the line, it could be the micro mentoring where it requires technical one-to-one mentoring for a longer period. It's not at 1 month or 2 months, it should be for minimum of 1 to 3 years so that the mentor, entrepreneur and mentor can sail through for some time so that the entrepreneur gets leading from the mentor, one thing. And the entrepreneur also should not shy away from having as many mentors as possible. It is not one person can solve the problems, they should have as many mentors as possible. And mentors also can as many entrepreneurs as possible so that they can do a lot of justice to the position we want these takes. And it, one thing it requires is passion, another thing it requires for social entrepreneurship should be free or something different.
Yeah.
That mechanism one has to work out. How to work out is one question we can discuss.
Yeah, good. Thank you very much. I mean, as we are hopefully through the Babel platform having, we all have a facility for online mentorship, which I think is the way forward, right? Because offline mentorship is just very difficult to sustain. So hopefully that's an issue that we can address. Share experiences.
We all felt that there's a need for a platform where peer learning could take place, not only about successful enterprises but also unsuccessful ones, so that the same learning is not repeated. And we have decided to launch our own platform. Just decided. So a name
don't duplicate our approach.
So, and the second most important thing is we are all into training and teaching social entrepreneurship, but there's a need to bring theory into practice. So
yeah.
A lot of initiatives to be focused on that, where we have to include experiential learning, handholding, more of incubation happening. And also, lack of ideas amongst the youth today. Probably we could blame that on the forceful curriculum we have and marks being pressurized on children. But there are organizations where they encourage children to come out with innovative ideas. At the age of 10, one of the group members has shared. Probably social entrepreneurship should start very young. Right from school, not just in college. So more of creative ideas would come at that stage. And we could use social media to leverage technology and what do I say, get more and more people participating in the exercise. And Aramiman said, there's a concept called build a little, field a little, and that's what we are aiming at. So we want more and more people to start coming and talking to fellow social entrepreneurs and encouraging more and more people to join this.
Okay, very good. Thank you very much. Excellent. So, lastly, but not least, identifying the problem. And the major thing is need is different for different groups.
That is what then each institution can involve their students for identifying and addressing the needs. That is one aspect they can look at it. Then even build rural build forums to rural areas to involve people in social entrepreneurship actions. That is two ways now you can look at it, because we have identified lot of issues also from in each locality. That is why if Bangalore, no, something is there, those who are staying in Bangalore, they can look at it, do that issues and focus on or build forums for not to solve such types of issues. Those who are in Tamil Nadu, each area if they are looking at, I think we can reach to more people. That is what our group has.
Thank you very much for your contribution. That was illuminating for us to hear the challenges you face, but also some of the ideas you have. And what we're going to do is take those ideas away, and we will see how we can integrate that with the existing tools we have so we can better serve you. But it's been very revealing in terms of some of the, you know, some of the challenges you have, as I said, as individual institutions. And for us, and the takeaway for us, I think, is how we can leverage our collective power to help access government influence and corporate influence in particular, but also provide a platform to share those experiences. And that's hopefully what we can do through our network portal, which Sandeep will now talk about.